Now, by and large, devotees of Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies seem to believe that scarcity is the true value proposition. If you think about a fiat currency issued by a central bank, say by the Reserve Bank of India or the US Federal Reserve, these central banks can print their currency at will in basically infinite quantities. Bitcoin, by contrast, is limited to at most 21 million, and about 19 million have been mined so far. And it is created at a very set schedule of one Bitcoin roughly every 10 minutes. Now, to an economist, this is a slightly dubious proposition that scarcity alone can create value. But certainly at a time when investors around the world, particularly in the advanced economies, are very eager to find financial assets that might provide a hedge against inflation, that might provide decent returns, Bitcoin has gained a lot of traction as a financial asset, and many other cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin have done the same. We are certainly at the cusp of some dramatic changes in the nature of money. Now, digital payments, of course, are nothing new, even to a country like India or other middle-income countries like China and Kenya, where cash is increasingly giving way to forms of payment that are electronic and that are largely intermediated through our mobile phones in the palms of our hands. But what is striking is that we are now at the cusp of a revolution that has been started, of course, by Bitcoin. And that, I think, is going to take us a very long way in terms of transforming money as we know it. Now, Bitcoin came right after the financial crisis broke out in the US, and it came with a very alluring idea of allowing people to conduct financial transactions without the use of central bank money or relying on a traditional financial institution such as a commercial bank. And the timing was very propitious because right after the global financial crisis, trust in governments and in banks and other traditional financial institutions was at a very low ebb. So the idea of being able to use what is effectively a decentralized medium of exchange, that is one that is not intermediated by any central trusted third party, and that would allow you to conduct your transactions using just your digital identities, that was a very alluring proposition. Now, in its early days, Bitcoin was used largely to finance illicit activities of various sorts within and across national borders, but that use has petered out over time. And more importantly, Bitcoin has not delivered well on its fundamental purpose. Now, Bitcoin, of course, is very volatile value, but in addition, the network cannot process a large volume of transactions, at best a handful per second compared to millions on many other payment platforms. In addition, it is somewhat slow, a little cumbersome to use. So Bitcoin has instead become what it was not supposed to be, which is a pure speculative financial asset. If you think about a fiat currency issued by a central bank, say by the Reserve Bank of India or the US Federal Reserve, these central banks can print their currency at will in basically infinite quantities. Bitcoin, by contrast, is limited to at most 21 million, and about 19 million have been mined so far. And it is created at a very set schedule of one Bitcoin roughly every 10 minutes. Now, to an economist, this is a slightly dubious proposition that scarcity alone can create value. But certainly at a time when investors around the world, particularly in the advanced economies, are very eager to find financial assets that might provide a hedge against inflation, that might provide decent returns, Bitcoin has gained a lot of traction as a financial asset. And many other cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin have done the same. Now, while Bitcoin has not worked well in its stated purpose, there are other cryptocurrencies that have come up that try to fill in the gaps left by Bitcoin. There is a new breed of cryptocurrencies called stable coins that get their stable value essentially by being backed up by stores of liquid securities denominated in those fiat currencies. Now, stable coins, I think, are likely to get some traction because they're fulfilling a fundamental need in many economies for good low-cost digital payments and good cross-border payments as well. Cross-border payments, that is across countries, still remain beset by a lot of inefficiencies in terms of speed, the expense, the difficulty of tracking them in real time. So the prospect that stable coins might help get around these problems is certainly an attractive one. Now, given all these developments in money, central banks have not been staying idle. Many central banks around the world have begun experimenting with digital versions of their own currencies, which are called central bank digital currencies or CBDCs. Now, there are different motivations at play in issuing CBDCs. In some countries, the objective is to broaden financial inclusion, that is, give virtually the entire population easy access to a low-cost digital payment system without necessarily having a bank account or a credit card, although a CBDC itself could become a portal for basic banking products and services. In some advanced economies like Sweden, the motivation is quite different. In Sweden, the private sector is doing a perfectly good job of providing low-cost digital payments that everybody has access to. But the Swedish central bank, the Riksbank, wants to make sure that the entire payments infrastructure is not in the hands of the private sector, and that in fact, you can have a backstop in the form of an e-krona or a digital krona in case the private payments infrastructure should face any technological or confidence issues. Then there is China, where a different set of motivations is at play. China, like India, has done very well in terms of providing digital payments to a large fraction of the population of the country. Unlike in India, the government has not played a direct role so far. There was a regulatory void that was filled by two very large payment providers, Alipay and WeChat Pay, which have done a fantastic job of blanketing the country with low-cost digital payments. But it comes at a cost. Those two payment providers now dominate the payment space and are not making it easy for new entrants who could come in, provide competition and further innovation. In addition, the Chinese government is very concerned that these two large players now have access to a lot of data that they're not willing to share with the government and that they will reasonably enough exploit for commercial purposes. But whatever happens with these, it's clear that around the world, we're going to see central bank digital currencies beginning to coexist with cash. And I think as we all get used to the convenience of digital payments, ultimately it's going to give way to purely digital forms of payments rather than just having cash. Is this all going to have an implication for the international monetary system? Could a digital version of the yuan rival the dollar? I think not. Maybe as a payment mechanism, if you had easy access to the digital yuan around the world, maybe the Chinese yuan could become used somewhat more as a payment currency. But ultimately, the dollar's role as the global reserve currency is determined by the fact that it has very strong institutions backing it up. An independent central bank, an institutionalized system of checks and balances, and the rule of law. And China has shown no indication it plans to move in this direction. There are other concerns related to privacy, which might be lost if we move to a world with just digital payments. I think, in fact, India is taking a very sensible approach to these issues, providing biometric forms of identity that everybody in the population has access to. And more important, in the form of the UPI, the Unified Payments Interface, providing a payments infrastructure that the private sector can then innovate on top of. And that, I think, is going to be an exemplar for many countries around the world. And the fact that the Indian government is also thinking of having data aggregators who would essentially allow consumers who ultimately own the data to control who sees the data and how that is used, that I think is going to serve as a model for much of the world.